that guy right there?
I think that's Chris. Who's that stud? I don't know.
Oh, sorry. It's like a lawyer.
He's my lawyer. Direct all questions to him.
Yeah, looks familiar. Yeah.
I think I have it.
All right, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
You guys fired up to be here?
Yes.
All right, cool. All right, so this is going to be a learning experience, and especially for those of you guys that have, who's done an annuity before?
Oh, probably just this.
I thought you meant boot camp.
No. Okay. Right. Who's its first boot camp here with me? Okay, so a lot of you guys. Yeah. Okay. Well, regardless, whatever, if it's been my life insurance boot camp or my annuity boot camp, it doesn't matter. Okay, so today's going to be a great learning experience. I'm going to preframe a few things. One, any questions you guys have, wait till the very end. Okay, because I want to be able to get through the material and be able to give you guys detailed answers. Okay. Based on what I have, I should go for about an hour, hour and a half, so that'll leave anywhere between half an hour to 45 minutes for Q&A so I can answer any very specific questions. Okay, sound good?
Right. Yes.
Okay.
So write them down.
Yeah. Basically, write them down.
Right. As they come up, write them down.
All right. And if you guys notice, I do have stuff up here with me. I have Transamerica pens. I have, you guys know I'm a big Grant Cardone fan. So I got some of the bracelets. I'm giving my team, because you guys know we're on an S&D run, you guys are wearing the yellow ones. It says hashtag whatever it takes, right? So my team are getting those, but I'll have all the other green ones, right? The green one says hustle, hashtag hustle muscle, keep pushing. The red one says be positive, no negativity allowed. And the blue one says success is my duty, 10 times.
I want that one.
Okay. So that's why I'm just preframing. I may stop in between and ask you guys questions, make sure you guys are paying attention.
Where the pens with
Mike? Swipe me up first.
Stylus pens. And now here's the reason, guys, is you guys know when I do my boot camps, I like doing stuff like this because I want to bring a lot of value to you guys because I want you guys to get better out in the field, right? That's the whole purpose of these, right? I'm taking time out of my schedule to do this for you guys, so let's make it very productive. And please use the info I give you guys.
Yes.
Please. Because I want to help get Nick to the next level. Right, and the only way that's going to happen is if we all individually get to our next level, right? So I will stop periodically and I will ask questions. And based on the question, I'll kind of pick and choose what I give out. Right, and you guys have seen me, I typically give out books too. Right, but I'm going to wait until I do another, say, life insurance boot camp, because that's what, you know, most of you guys are really learning and writing out in the field. And, you know, some of those questions can be a lot harder. I would rather give you a book for that. Right. So like I said, today I want it to be very productive. All questions wait till the end, if possible, right? And you know, the one thing I want you guys to also remember is there is no stupid question.
Just stupid answer.
Well, not even that. Right? But the only stupid question, right? The only stupid question is the one that isn't asked. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's what my teacher meant.
Yeah. There is no stupid question. There's only one that's not asked. Okay, and you guys will run into a very different variety of clientele that is out there that will have different questions. Okay, but to kind of put a few things in perspective, pretty much all qualified plans they work all the same. Okay, and you guys understand like how our IRAs, 401ks work, right? Money goes in with before tax dollars, grows tax deferred, and then when do they actually pay the taxes? When they access it. Okay, this is what I like to do out in the field. $1 million question. Do you know what your tax bracket's going to be when you're 65 and retired?
No.
So why would you put your money inside an account that you have no clue what your taxes are going to be?
Because it's going to reduce my taxable income throughout the years.
You know what? That's a great point that a lot of people like to bring up. By tone. Look at just what Arthur says. Okay, house is paid off. Kids are out the house. What tax write-offs do you have?
None.
So what does that do to your taxable income?
Okay.
Unless you plan on living on less income, that's the only way you pay less in taxes. unless you're a corporation, but that's a whole nother facet which you guys will learn soon enough. Right, I was just telling Nick, I just finished my S Corp, so I'm really excited for that. Yeah. I know Arthur's got his corporation, his nonprofit as well. Right, so, I mean, you guys are here in business, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Here to make profit?
Yes.
Okay, learn how to keep most of your profits. So seek out guidance from your trainer or your SME that has already had a lot of experience with that, right?
Yeah.
Especially those that are making hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars in WFG. Right? Because that's information you can use for your benefit. Okay? So let's start with some of the basics. So I'm gonna go from getting you guys to understand what an annuity is, right? Because how many of you guys can tell me what an annuity is? Outside of the field leadership, who can tell me what an annuity is? You want to give it a shot, Marky?
I'm going to give it a shot. Okay, so basically you want to take either a lump sum of money and you want to make it, you want it to outlive you, basically. So you want to be able to have income coming in, you can have it be paid to you right away while it's growing interest, or you can have
it's
it.
Good.
Okay.
Very close. All right. Okay. So I forgot to turn this on. Okay. So what is an annuity? Oops. It's a contract with a life insurance company. It can, what happened to the screen? It's a contract with a life insurance company. It can be a single premium purchase or multiple premium purchase contract. So what that means is somebody can take money, whether it's coming, say, from an old 401k, IRA, TSA, TSP, CalSTRS, CalPERS, pension, an inheritance, a settlement, a mutual fund, a stocks, whatever the case may be, just a lump sum of money, where they move it over to the life insurance company, right? Oh, it's like going really fast. Okay, so what happens is here, it allows the money to grow, it has a guaranteed principal, allow it to grow with a market index, right? You guys are already familiar with that?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Market index that's tied to a cap, participation. Who's sending me something? Oh, mm-hmm. Mike, I heard the airdrop go off.
Oh, I got it.
Yeah, no, I look shitty. And a spread. So you guys understand the cap, right? Just like an IUL. There's participation, so that means a percentage of what the market does. So like, let's just say, the S&P 500 does 10%, and your participation is, say, 100%, mm-hmm. Your client gets the full 10%. You guys follow up? So if your participation is 100% of whatever the S&P 500 does, mm-hmm. Let's just say the S&P 500 does 10%, you get 100% of the 10%, so your client gets 10%. Now, if the participation was, say, 70%, how much does the client get?
70%.
Okay, you guys follow up? Mm-hmm. The other part is a spread. So as an example, and I'll go through this, there's, when I get a little bit closer to the end, you guys will see what I mean by spread. It's the client will get whatever the market does with a small haircut. So meaning, like, let's just say the S&P 500, say, does 20%, but the spread is, say, 3%, right? How much does the client get?
17.
Correct. That's what they mean by spread. So there's only three ways that they can earn interest in your account. You guys follow? And the last part has available income riders. So when I get a little bit closer to that, we'll talk about the riders and how they work. Keep in mind, a rider comes at a cost to the client. The annuity itself has no cost, okay? It's completely free to the client. There's no fees, no nothing like that. Right, so like if I'm sitting down with Arthur, I know he's been in the military, he's got a TSP, correct? Mm-hmm. And when I talk to him about protecting what he's already built so far in his TSP, let's just say it's $500,000, I can explain to him, look Arthur, what we're gonna do is we're gonna move your TSP into an annuity, we're gonna guarantee your principal, right? You can grow with the market, you can never lose because of the market, and we could potentially put on an income rider where you never outlive the money, right? Because inside of, you guys understand how a qualified plan works. If they have a 401k, TSA, any of those qualified plans, it's just like a glorified savings account. Once the money's gone, what happens? Money's gone. Versus if that money's inside of an annuity and they're still alive, like you say, Arthur puts in $500,000. And over, say, the next 20 years, it grows to say half, you know, 750 grand, and he starts living off the 750 grand, but let's just say he's used more in benefits than what he's already built, the 750,000, the insurance company, because he is still alive by contract, will still keep paying his family money while he's still alive. Now, if he dies, then it's gone.
Right.
But let's just say he started taking income, right, from it, and it's grown to 750,000. He starts taking income, but let's just say he's taking 100,000 in income. And for whatever reason, God forbid, knock on wood, right, he passes away. Do you think that the insurance company is gonna, you know, just kind of let it all sit and they keep everything? No. So they're only gonna pay back what's left over in principal. So if he's used 100,000 income, but he originally put in 500 grand, his family still gets 400 grand back as a death benefit. Do you guys follow?
Yep.
Okay, that's very important to know. Very, very important. Because that question will come up out in the field. And I'm telling you guys from personal experience. Right, like last year, I think I did, if I remember correctly, a little over $1 million in production in annuities. The year before that, I think I did about $2 million. Right, so I think I got enough experience to tell you guys what to do out in the field, right? Now, the types of annuities that are out there are fixed annuities. Fixed annuities are, you know, just like what the name implies, gives a fixed interest rate. That can be between anywhere from 2 to 5% depending on the carrier. And I'll talk about the carriers when I get closer to the end. Okay. A fixed index annuity, that's one we're gonna mainly talk about. A fixed index annuity works like a 401k or an IRA where it still grows tax deferred. The only difference is you have a guaranteed floor. So you're guaranteed never to lose money based on market performance. And you guys will hear me say that multiple times. There's also immediate annuities. So meaning, let's just say, if I'm sitting down with CJ and he says, okay, Matt, I have $500,000. I don't need the income right now, but I will in the next year. Then we can put him into an immediate annuity where he can start living off the income in the next 12 months, right? Do not put into a fixed index annuity or fixed annuity. They will charge them a fee for accessing the money early. So if they specifically say they're gonna need the money in the next year, put it inside of an immediate annuity. Do not put it in a fixed or fixed index annuity. They don't like that. It's frowned upon, right? And then there are variable annuities. There's nobody's securities license in here, but that's another form of, well, except for Shinika. there are variable annuities. I'm not gonna talk about those because really nobody's securities license except for Shinika, right? But we're mainly gonna talk about fixed index annuities today, okay? So just kind of keep in mind some of the things I've already explained to you guys. If someone needs the money now, in the next 12 months, immediate. If somebody wants a guaranteed rate of return, stick with the fixed annuity. But now here's the thing. Sometimes you can bring it up, and I'll talk about this a little bit, you know, later, is why limit yourself to only 2 to 5% when you can potentially make 10 to 15 to 18, or in some cases, no cap. Right, a lot of you guys are like, wait, there's no cap in fixed index annuities? Yes, there is. And I'll talk about that too, okay? So, here's a quick video about fixed index annuities.
When you think about the years ahead, what are you looking forward to? For most people, the answer is a nice balance of favorite pastimes and new adventures, busy and tranquil moments. Balance is also important in your financial life between reward and risk, nest egg preservation and growth. No one knows what the future holds. That's why indexed annuities attract the attention of retirement savers looking to achieve some balance and peace of mind, no matter what happens in the financial markets. In 2008 and 9, Americans lost an unprecedented amount of retirement savings because of stock market volatility. Those who own indexed annuities lost nothing. So what are annuities, and specifically indexed annuities? All annuities are basically a contract between you and an insurance company. You pay for the annuity in either a single lump sum or multiple payments over time. In return, the insurance company promises to pay you money from the annuity in a single or series of payments. Like many other longer-term financial products, annuities have a surrender fee for early withdrawal, the terms of which depend on your contract. There are two categories of annuities, fixed and variable. With variable, the consumer assumes the risk for the annuity's value. And with fixed, the insurance company assumes the risk. An indexed annuity is a type of fixed annuity, but it has a distinct way of calculating annual interest, using a formula based on changes in the performance of a stock, bond, or commodity index. The index is used as an external benchmark. You do not actually invest in it. While the interest you earn, and when you get it, depend on the features of your particular contract, generally indexed annuities have an interest rate floor, a participation rate, and a cap that determine the amount of interest you earn. Your interest earnings rate always remains somewhere between the floor and the cap. It does not rise above the cap, even if the index goes higher. Conversely, it never falls below zero, even if the index goes way down. So the value of your money will never decline for as long as it is in the annuity, but it can increase with a rising index. Once interest is credited, it also can never be lost due to interest rate adjustments or negative market fluctuations, and it may even compound. That means more potential growth than other fixed annuities or simple savings plans, and less risk than variable annuities and other more volatile investments, bringing some balance to your retirement plan. Like all annuities, the index type offers tax-deferred growth. You aren't taxed on interest earnings while your money stays in the annuity. The process of choosing an index annuity can also give you peace of mind. These financial products are backed by some of the world's largest, most reputable insurance companies, and can only be sold by licensed insurance professionals who are mandated to receive product-specific training. Companies are required, in most cases, by their state's insurance department to ensure that every indexed annuity sale is suitable for the customer's age, financial situation, and goals. And while agents are paid commissions, no sales compensation is ever deducted from your annuity principal. Now that you know the basics about indexed annuities, learn more here.
Cool, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, so remember, just like what they're talking about, it's just like in IUL, where it's always indexed. So once every single year when it has accrediting, it locks in the gains, can never lose money, right? It's always like a staircase, right? Market goes up, you take that step up, locks in the gains. If the market has a downturn, you stay right where you're at. Or unless the market continues to grow the following year, then you're taking another step. Or another step, or another step. You know, it works just like an IUL. The only difference is because the money hasn't been taxed yet, the client still has to pay the taxes on the back end, right? But this is a good way where if somebody says, okay, well, and these are conversations you guys will have, just like some of the ones I'm having and Arthur's having and Cynthia's having. It's like sometimes some people are like, well, I'm still planning on getting Social Security, plus I have a few other income sources. Then it's like, okay. And something like this is one of the last things, or close to one of the last things you want to touch. Only because you want the tax-deferred growth, right? Now, also too, guys, keep one thing in mind, because it is a qualified plan, right? The client, if they are 70 and a half, they will still need to pay required minimum withdrawals, or RMDs. Mm-hmm. Meaning they need to take out enough to satisfy their taxes for that year. So as an example, I'll give you guys an example. One of my clients, her name is Jean. She is 80, I think she's 83 now, if I remember correctly. I moved roughly about $200,000 for her between an IRA and an inheritance. And on the IRA, that's one that has a majority of it, 150 grand. She had to take out $6,000 for her R&D. So she gets a check for $6,000. And that she has to pay the taxes on, which she's in about a 35% tax bracket. So she has to pay about $1,800 to $2,000 a year just in taxes. By the way, that's standard by the IRS and government. That's why you guys got to remember, that's why when you talk to people about IUL, why it's so advantageous, of why you don't have to worry about R&Ds, right? And by the way, a lot of people don't know they have to take R&Ds. Probably at least like 70-80% of people I've ever sat down with in the 8 years I've been doing this don't even know they have to pay RMDs on their 401ks or IRAs. Right? Some of you guys are looking at like, I didn't even know that. Right? But those are things that you want to know ahead of time coming into an appointment so you can explain it to the client. Right? Okay, some recommended reading. You guys know I'm huge on it. Right? Three books I will recommend you guys get your hands on. that talks about annuities. Patrick Kelly, Stress Free Retirement. So you guys have read the book, Tax Free Retirement?
Yeah.
Right? And The Retirement Miracle. He has a book on strictly fixed index annuities. So if you guys don't have that book, get it, get your hands on it. Right? Tony Robbins, Money Mastering the Game. Great book. It's like 600 pages long.
Yeah.
It's like this thick. Totally worth it though. Took me 3 months to finish, but I learned so much from him because he interviews the 50 wealthiest people pretty much in the world and how they save and invested money. And then what he does is they take all those tips and he puts it into a formula in his book, Unshakable. Unshakable is freaking awesome. Like, I freaking devoured that book. I could not put it down. Like, it makes so much sense reading. I'm like, okay, that makes sense. I'm like, okay, I'm doing some of it, but I'm not doing all of it yet. Right? So I'd highly recommend, you guys want to learn about annuities, get your hands on those three books. All right, so now, what are annuities good for? Lump sums of money coming from qualified plans. So we're just talking about this, right? So your 401ks, tax-sheltered annuities or tax-sheltered accounts, 403bs, traditional IRAs, tax-sheltered accounts, TSPs or thrift savings plan, CalSTRS, CalPERS, pensions, whatever the case may be. Now, here's the thing about the pension, though, I want you guys to realize, is you can't move it if they already start taking income from it, if they already start taking benefits from it. They're already locked in. Yeah, pension, traditional pension. If you can catch them before they start taking income from it, you can move it.
Really?
Yes.
Even if they stop working there, but as long as
I'm going to talk about that. Okay, so there's a couple things you have to keep in mind. All these other ones are no problem to move, right? As long as they are not with their employer anymore or they hit 59 and a half, which I'll talk about here in a minute. Okay? So that's one way. Another way of other accounts that you can move are non-qualified funds. So qualified funds are money that hasn't been taxed yet. Non-qualified means they've already been taxed. So things like cash in the bank, right? Settlements, mutual funds, stocks, CDs, Roth IRAs. Roth IRAs, guys, are independent. So you can move these wherever you want. Okay, so if they want to put into, like, if you guys understand how a Roth works, it's just based like an IRA, just tax-free, okay? Now, who can tell me the difference between a traditional IRA and a Roth IRA? Besides Shanika. Okay, Shanika, go ahead.
Traditional IRAs are generally put away with pre-tax money.
Correct.
And they also grow tax-deferred.
Correct.
Right? Roth IRAs. You can put them in with its after-tax money. The distributions come out tax-free except for the capital gains, so you get all your principal out first without having to pay taxes on the back end.
Okay. You can follow up on that?
Yes.
Okay, you're Shanika.
I mean,
one thing about the Roth. There's one thing about the Roth.
There's no 59 and a half rule.
That too.
Yeah.
There's no prior R&D on there.
There's
and
no
also,
there's no
also is that after a 5-year commitment, you can pull your money out, your principal, without any time penalties.
That's why there's no
59
and
a half. Yep, that is very true.
There's also income limits.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah.
Okay, what are the income limitations?
Oh. I know it's lower for a Roth than it is for the traditional.
Okay. So now let's talk about income limitations. Since we're on the subject, it changes every single year.
Yeah.
This year, they just raised the income limitations. Okay, so on a Roth IRA, if a single person is making under $120,000, single, or if they make over $120,000, or combined household income, they make over $195,000 a year, they are disqualified from owning a Roth IRA. Okay. By government and IRS standards, they're considered rich. But let's be honest, we live in California. If you're making $200,000 a year, are you really rich? No.
Yeah.
That's why we got WFG. Right? Over $120,000 single or over $195,000 married, filing jointly or even separately, doesn't matter. Combined household income is over $195,000, you're disqualified.
How much is a single?
$120,000. So when somebody, like, I've had clients actually call me, and they're like, hey, we want to do a Roth IRA, and I know they make over 200 grand a year, I'm like, you guys can't.
There's no way around. I mean,
nope,
no
nope. Because they go by your tax return.
Yep.
They go by everything that's on paper. So even if, like, the prior year they show that, now, let's kind of play a different scenario. Now, if they had a Roth IRA before they start making those types of income,
right,
they can still keep contributing.
Okay.
They just can't, you know, in a sense, yeah, they can't put more.
But you can only put
up until that point.
Yeah.
Right. Up until that point where they make that income, then that's it.
But if they already had it and they start making that income,
they can't contribute anymore.
So that's why, when you talk to people about the IUL, I'm always going to balance back and forth between the two. That's why the IUL is so advantageous.
Right.
You know, you get a client, like the example I used during pregame. My latest client, he makes like $350, $400 a year. He's already maxed out his 401k. He's already maxed out his traditional IRA. He's like, I don't know where else to put my money. And I said, and I explained to him how would I, because they wanted whatever my other clients had. I said, okay, this is what they got. He's like, wait, so you're telling me I could put money inside of this life insurance policy. I already pay taxes on it. It grows tax deferred like my 401k or my IRA, and I can access it tax free. Yeah, he's like, done. He's like, how much more can I put in over the next couple years? So I know I'm gonna come back in probably 1 or 2 years and increase his policy, right? And now traditionally, you know what happens? They issue a whole new policy. So guess what? New points, new cash flow. That's why you do your annual reviews.
Wait, how did they get a new policy?
Because let's just say he's hit the limitation of how much he can put in.
And they got to increase the policy.
Yeah, let's just say he pays 25 grand. He's like, but I want to put in 50 grand. Okay, then you need a bigger policy.
Mm.
So you upgrade his car policy, you write a whole new policy. So that's why you got to know this stuff. Know the limitations, know the industry, right? That's how you look professional. That's how you get more referrals. That's how people perceive you. That's how you attract more clients. Right, like some people, they get mad that I post my cycles. I'm like, okay, what are you mad about? You know why? They're probably jealous. Cause like, dang, I wish. Right, like I only used to make only 1,800, 2 grand a month at Costco, and we make $2,800 on one cycle. You know, for some people, that sells them a dream. It's like, okay, well then, when are you gonna get your butt in here? Right. But now here. Right, the non-qualified funds, these are good things to know about because you can put these into annuities. But also too, keep in mind, you can also, you know, some of these you can liquidate to put into an IUL too. It's not recommended half the time, especially if somebody's securities registered. It's like,
yeah, no.
Right? But this is important stuff for you guys to know. So remember, qualified accounts are what?
401k,
okay. Non-qualified?
Cash, settlements, mutual funds, stocks, CDs, Roth IRAs.
Okay, so whenever you do an annuity, it will ask, is it coming from, are they qualified funds or non-qualified funds? Because that makes a difference too. When somebody uses non-qualified funds and they put it into annuity, they don't pay taxes when they access the money. They don't pay taxes on the principal. You only pay taxes on the growth, the interest, right? So if a client puts in 100 grand and it grows to say, you know, 200 grand, they're gonna only pay taxes on the other 100 grand, not the full 200. You guys follow?
Yeah.
It's only on the interest grow, okay? Now, what allows someone to move their qualified plan? So this is a question that Cynthia has. Okay, there's really two qualifying events. One, they've hit 59 and a half, and they're still working or they're not working, doesn't matter, as long as they're 59 and a half. The other part is they've severed employment from his or her employer, right? So I mean, they've either been laid off, they've retired, or they've been terminated. And for most people, if they have an IRA or Roth, it's independent. They can move it wherever they want. Okay. Now they kind of go back one step. On a traditional IRA, and even this applies to 401ks, there's actually a limitation on when somebody can write it off. Okay, Shanika's like, yep, I know this. Okay, anybody know the answer?
What'd you say?
Another question?
Okay, There is a limitation on when somebody, how far, how much income someone has to make for them to be able to write off their contributions to an IRA or 401k. You guys know this? Mm-hmm. No? Okay, better write this down. Okay. You guys know, what's the maximum that goes into a 401k?
$18,075.
As of this year.
Is that per year?
Okay. Now, if they're over 50, they have the catch-up provision, which is an additional
$5,000 more.
Okay, that's an important number to know. If they're over 50, they're allowed a catch-up provision of an additional $5,000 per year.
So $5,000
additional. They can go to additional.
If they're over.
So it would be $6,000.
$5,000.
So it's $23,500 maximum.
Max is some 18.5. So you add $5,000 to it, then you go up to 20. Is that 23.5.
Okay. Now, here's the thing you also guys have to remember, is a lot of people are under the impression that they can write off the whole contribution. No. That is false. They said, oh, I can write off the entire 18.5. False. You only write off based on your current tax bracket. Right? So, as an example, the couple I just sat down with on Monday, he's maxed out his 401k, 18.5. He can only write off what his current tax bracket, which is basically 40%. So 40% of the 18.5 is what? Half is 9,000, so give or take about 8,000. And when you're making $300,000-$400,000, it doesn't change your tax bracket. And especially how they just redid the tax reform. You guys remember with the tax reform that just happened? Oh, you guys better keep up with this stuff. I've been talking to Shanique like every single day about the corporation, like how the tax changes. Okay, anyway. So, if somebody says, yeah, I get to write off the whole thing, no, that's false. You can only write off based on what your tax bracket is. So, even if someone's contributing, say, $3,000 a year, and their tax bracket is 30%, how much are they actually lowering their taxable income by? 30%, which is how much of that
$3,000?
30% of 3,000? 900. Really, is $900 going to change your tax bracket? No. Okay, so reference IUL. You guys see what I'm doing every single time? These are the important things to do. Now, here are the limitations when it comes to someone being able to write that stuff off. If you have a married couple and one has access to the 401k, okay, they have to stay under making $185,000 a year combined. Or single, it's $140,000. That's the only way they can write it off. Okay. If only one has access. If neither has access to it, then the limitation goes up higher. It goes well over $200,000. So that there is certain limitations to when somebody can actually still write it off. You guys follow? Mm-hmm. But now you're talking about people, $300,000-$500,000, million a year. Right? You okay, CJ? I was about to throw my remote at you. I see you dozing off over there. Right? Okay. But like I said, an IRA or Roth IRA is independent. They can move it wherever they want. Okay. But also keep in mind, if they move it in a way, that's also their contribution for the year. Mm-hmm. So they wouldn't be able to add to it. Okay. For next bracelet. What's the most that can go into a traditional IRA?
18.5.
No.
In traditional?
Traditional IRA.
6,700.
What do you say?
55.
Oh, yeah, traditional. So I'm thinking about 401k. Okay, my bad.
What was it?
It's the same.
5,500.
It's the same.
5,500, traditional IRA. Seth, that's a whole
lot of
money.
25%
of their annualized income.
Can you
raise
it to that?
Yeah.
You didn't ask the question.
My book says 60.
No, it's 25% of their annualized income.
I'm the one.
So, like, as an example, okay, like, let's just say let's say Janice and Byron has their, they have a corporation. This is a higher end example, right? They have a corporation, and let's just say they pay themselves a salary of say like 50 grand, right? They can contribute up to 25% of their annualized income, which is 7,500, and put it into a SEP IRA. Now, if they're making a lot more money, let's just say they're making, say, 100 grand, the most they can put in is 25,000 and still be a write-off. Okay? Pretty cool, huh?
Yeah.
That's why when you guys start working with like small to medium-sized business owners, you want to know this stuff because they will ask. And by the way, a lot of them have already done their research.
Yes.
They just need to be told what to do. Right? So you talk about SEP IRA, that's a whole other ballgame. Right? Like, I have certain plans for myself. I have certain plans for myself, especially now that the corporation's done, so I'm just waiting for that. Anyway, okay. Now, here's the thing. How do you find these types of accounts? Because these will not fall in your lap. You have to ask for them. You have to ask for them. Okay? You guys have heard G say this. You have to have a nose for money. Ask a bunch of questions. Here are a few ways you can do it. During your KTP, if you guys have been out in the field with me, you know how I like to do things.
Mm-hmm.
I like to ask, on a scale of 1 to 10, how well do you understand money? And they'll spit out a number. Okay, great. My job is to take that up one or two levels. I'll say, okay, where are you saving your money? Oh, we save money into our savings account. Oh, we save money into a 401k. Okay, great. How much are you saving into your 401k? And then I'll also ask them, hey, by the way, do you have, hey Gail, good to see you. Everybody say hi, Gail.
Hi, Gail.
Hi,
everyone.
She's, I know Gail from my networking group in Chino Hills. I invited her out to kind of take a look at everything that, you know,
great,
we're doing too at the same time. So by the way, guys, a little background about Gail. She specializes in real estate, specifically real estate in probate.
Okay.
That's one of her specialties. Because she has seen her family go through it, and she's like, okay, this is what I want to do, right?
Right.
So if you guys know anybody that's going through probate, has property in probate, she's the one person you guys want to talk to and get to know her a little bit better. Did you bring business cards with you? Yep.
I did.
Okay.
And trust, also, if you're in a trust.
Yep.
Trust.
Yep.
Thank you.
So here's the thing, guys. This is the reason why you network with people. Right, because you can make partnerships with other people in different industries. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So, here's one of them. Do you currently have a 401k plan with your employer or have a 401k from a previous employer? That's what I ask. And sometimes they will say, oh, actually, I do have an old 401k from a previous employer. Okay, what I want you guys to remember is take a mental note and say, okay, I got to remember that because at the end of my presentation, I want to bring that up again.
Mm-hmm.
Now, keep in mind, guys, you don't sell two products on one. You don't sell life insurance and annuity at the same appointment. You do a follow-up. You don't do both at the same time. Okay, because then you're going to confuse the hell out of them. You don't want to do that, right? Another way you can ask is, how many of you guys have the FLS sheet?
I don't have it with me.
It's on my computer. The one that shows clients, you know, all the client info? Okay, when you're going through that FLS sheet, on the back side, it asks about all their assets, right? What do they have in taxable accounts, tax-deferred, and tax-free accounts? So when you're going through there, you can simply ask, did you say you have an old 401k from a previous employer? That's another way to ask, right? But also, too, when I'm at the beginning of my presentation, I like to ask them where they're saving money for a reason. Because if they've been saving money consistently, right, then when you ask them, where are they saving their money? They're like, oh, I have like, they'll freely give you the information, by the way. They'll say, oh, I got like 30 grand in my savings account, right? Or I got 20 grand in a mutual fund, or I got 20 grand in stocks. That's a mental note for you guys to make, because when it comes time to do business, especially when it comes to an IUL, that's an opportunity for you guys to do a front load on a policy.
Mm-hmm.
Or if they are say, you know what, I want to protect this money, what can I do with it? And there you go. You can move inside of an annuity as well, right? So there are different ways you guys can do this. And now one that you can always ask is, have you received a settlement or inheritance recently? You guys would be surprised how many people actually receive settlements or inheritances that they have no clue what to do with. Right? Gail, you've seen that a lot.
I see it every day.
So these are questions you guys need to be asking out in the field so that it funnels to you. Right? But also too, it makes you look very professional in the field that you're trying to help them make sure that you're helping them move the money where it's supposed to go. Right? And that's why it's important that every single process, every single step of the way you're asking questions. Right? The best presentations are ones that ask a bunch of questions, not those that give a lot of statements. Correct?
Correct.
Yeah, correct.
Okay. And that's why you guys ask a lot of questions out in the field. It's okay. Don't think you're asking too many questions, because you'll uncover a lot of information just by asking the right questions. And that same thing applies when we're recruiting too. Right? Like if I went around the room and asked every single person why you're here, half of us will say we're here to make more money. But then a part of us will say, I love the crusade, like myself. Right? But of course I'm here to make money too. Right? But then sometimes some people, you know, they get into the industry because they've seen what happens to a family when they didn't have an advisor, or they didn't have a plan, or they didn't have life insurance. Right?
Mm-hmm.
That's why all the questions are so important. Okay? And of course, one other question, do you have money in mutual funds, CDs, or stocks? So just different ways that you can find money that's out there. Okay. Got it?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, this is my part. Okay, this is a presentation I developed probably about 4 or 5 years ago. Or no, it's probably longer than that. Longer than that. That's when we have Roberto Camacho who talked to us. So that would have been like 7 years ago when we were in Corona. So 7 years ago when we were in Corona, Shanika's like, yep, I remember. We had a gentleman named Roberto Camacho come into our office because he was really huge on rollovers, on annuities. And he was talking about him. He had a very simplified presentation, which I basically turned into this. Because he just asked a whole bunch of questions and he draws this out. I was like, I'll just make it a visual in Microsoft Word. Okay. So you guys notice it's a drawing between a graph between a 401k and an annuity. Okay. So I like to compare the two. Okay. So like let's just say if I'm sitting down with Cynthia and her husband Myron, right? They have an old 401k that they need to move, that I know that's the reason why I'm there in front of them. Okay. I want you guys to keep in mind how long this presentation actually takes me. Okay. So, Cynthia, you have an old 401k, right? And you know, I'll ask them how well they understand it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, inside of your 401k, do you have a guaranteed principal? Meaning you can't lose a penny?
No.
Okay. So with inside of an annuity, we can guarantee your principal, you never lose a penny based on market performance. Okay. We can also give you, depending on what your funds qualify for, there are different ways that you can earn interest on the account. So anywhere from a floor, right, a guaranteed 0%, up to a cap, but that depends on what you want to do, right? Another part is we can give you income for life, okay? Now most people understand that in a 401k, once you use up all the money, do you have any more money left over for income?
Mm-hmm.
Here, we can make sure you have income for life. And that's something you want to make sure you have, correct? And another part is we help protect your assets from probate.
Mm-hmm.
So that means you don't go through probate court, right? You don't have to, your family doesn't have to wait 6 months to 3 years to fight for all the assets that you've built up for your entire life. We can help you protect that.
Sounds great.
Okay. And also too, you may potentially get a signing bonus just for doing business with us. Be pretty awesome, right?
I'm gonna get that.
Okay, so if I were to give you an opportunity to help you qualify for this product, when would you take advantage of it? Now or in 5 years?
Now.
Okay, how long really is that conversation? Maybe 3 to 5 minutes. Maybe. Okay, you guys realize this is what I'm doing out in the field. It's a simple conversation, right? So now based on what we're just talking about, and if you guys want this, I can email it to everybody. Right, so just text me. I think everybody in here has my phone number, correct? I think everybody does. Text me with your email, if I don't have it already, and I can email this to you. And it's just something to put in your presentation booklet, right? Now, when she says, I want to take advantage of it now, okay, great. Now, the questions to ask to determine which is the correct annuity to write. So I need to know, okay, how much does she have if I don't already know? What will you use it for? And how soon do you need access to it? Okay, now these three questions are very important because depending on how much a client has, what is ultimately will also help determine which annuity you can go for because different companies require different premium minimums. Most are about $10,000. Okay. Now you will run into clients, the reason why I ask what will you use it for, there are a lot of clients out there that they don't need it for income. My client Jean that I was just talking about earlier, she's like, I don't need it for income. I have my pension, I have other stuff going on, I want to leave it for my kids and my grandkids. It's a legacy plan. Right? And then how soon do you need access to it? That's why I was asking, you know, CJ, how soon do you need it? Do you need it in the next year? Do you need it in the next 5 years, 10 years, 15 years? Because also got, you guys also got to remember, annuities still have, you guys saw in the video, surrender periods. Okay, shortest surrender period you can get in the market right now, depending on carrier, is 5 to 7 years. Longest roughly is about 10, especially in California because they've changed certain tax laws with the Department of Labor and stuff like that, it's 10 years. Okay. Now, don't call me, first of all. I don't do annuities, Crump does. So here's the contact info if you don't have it, you want to write that down. Because we used to be able to go directly to the carriers and get it done. But because of the Department of Labor changes over the past couple of years, they had everything funnel through Crump to act as basically the fiduciary. Okay. When you call, you hit option 3 and then option 4 for the annuity sales site. And when they pick up the phone, they will ask for your code, your name and your code number, and they'll say, okay, what can I help you with? And then you give them the client profile. How old they are, their name, how much money they got, and what do you think is going to be the best for them? Okay. Now, I will give you guys a few tidbits. I'm going to go over, talk about the three annuity companies I do business with within Crump. But it can really depend on the client. That's the power of being in WFG and then working with Crump is we can help pick and choose which one's going to be best for the client, right? So on their website, if you go through menu, recruiting and selling, product providers, you'll see Crump. On Crump's website, you can find the fixed index annuity page. They will show every single fixed index annuity company that we work with and all their rates. Okay, this is just an example of one of them. By the way, all the notes, you guys see, you see where it says only eligible agents? The only way you can get appointed with Allianz is if you've done at least $500,000 in production in a year. Okay, that's how you get pre-appointed. Or unless you're a CPA or you carry a 6 and 63 already, where you're already duly licensed. Okay. So at the end, by the way, Allianz has got some really great fixed index annuities, so you, that's why you want to get securities license or you write a bunch of annuities. Okay. Now let's kind of go over a few of them. One of my favorites, personally, is Nationwide. And what's Nationwide's slogan? There you go. Right? So, they have three annuities, but they all work the same. Okay, they have a New Heights 8, New Heights 9, New Heights 10. The difference between the 8, 9, and the 10 is how often it gets credited the interest. So, your New Heights 8 and 10 is every 2 years. Your 9 is every 3 years. But remember, it's an index change. And on these, if you look, remember you guys, I was telling you guys about participation or spread? This is all right here. So you can actually look, you can actually go on the Nationwide website where you can ask them for the rate sheet. They will give this to you. So if you look at, let's see. So as an example, let's say S&P 500 2 year. Index allocation A is 63% in. And that the strategy B is 35%. Okay, so that means if a client decides that they want B, they get 35% of whatever the market does. You guys follow? That's the participation. So that means, let's just say over that 2-year period, the S&P 500, say, does 20%, they get 35% of that, which is roughly about 7%, right? But remember, they still have the guaranteed floor. So that, those are some of the things you want to look at. Now, my personal recommendation has been the JP Morgan Mosaic. You can get a either strategy B is 100% of whatever it does, or you can get 120% strategy A, but there's a strategy spread of 1.2%. So it means they get 120% of whatever the JP Morgan Mosaic does, minus 1.2%. And that's been very, very popular right now. And that one, by the way, just so you understand, a JP Morgan Mosaic, that one performs really, really well when the S&P 500 is not doing so well. That one's actually a lot more consistent over time. Go ahead, Janice.
The minimum's on there, is that the minimum requirement?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So you guys notice here for an 8-year, and notice right here, you guys see where it's SPDA? Who knows what that means? Single premium deferred annuity. There's one with, I'm going to talk about with Voya, that's a flexible premium deferred annuity. So if they want to do multiple contributions, right? You guys notice for the 9 and the 10, it's a $25,000 minimum. Whether it's qualified funds or non-qualified, doesn't matter. It's just, it has to be that. But you also keep in mind, remember, that's only a single premium. Once it's in, that's it.
They can't contribute
anymore. No, they can't contribute anymore. Now, if they have multiple accounts, let's just say they want to put, maybe they have an old 401k and an IRA, and they want to put both into the same account, they can, because they're both qualified funds. Okay. Now, if they have an old 401k and they have cash, they can't. They have to do two separate policies. You can't commingle both of them. Because one hasn't paid taxes, one you already have.
Gotcha.
You guys follow up?
Yes.
That's why it's important to know whether it's qualified funds or
non-qualified.
There you go. Okay. And like I said before, there's also the surrender period. You guys will see that here. Now, let me kind of